Microtechnology can help in getting around even if you're disabled. There are now special adaptations for cars. It can help you to exercise and it can improve your muscle control. The chip has even found its way onto the number 108 bus in Weston-super-Mare.
Good afternoon. The time is 12:28 p.m.
This is Elsie, the first ever talking bus stop, and a good friend to people like Janet Matthews. Janet is blind. She can't read her local bus timetables and usually depends on asking someone which number bus is coming. Now, computer-controlled Elsie tells her everything she needs to know, starting with the numbers of the buses which pass this particular stop.
Good afternoon. Buses using this stop are the number 101. Next bus due at 2:16 p.m. The number 102.
On the bus, the driver dials his bus number into a small control box, which sends the information to a relay unit underneath. A loop in the road picks up the signal from the unit and tells Elsie the exact position of the bus.
The number 108 is approaching.
At present, Elsie is a prototype, only in use in Weston-super-Mare. But if the scheme is successful, it could be expanded. Janet Matthews thinks it should be.
Elsie has given back to myself and many other people that little bit of independence. It was very difficult for me to read the bus timetables. Now I just have to press a button and I get all the information I want. I think it would be a great thing if it could be other towns and many other parts of the country could have it also.
But getting about doesn't only mean getting on and off public transport. For many people, simply moving a limb can be a problem.
Pull them up.
This is Springfield School in Huntingdon. Fiona has cerebral palsy.
Pull the toes up hard, see if we can get the monkey on.
Sensors are attached to her muscles. Every time she moves her toes, signals are sent to a computer, which in turn controls the toy monkey.
He's good, isn't he? You're making them do that, won't you? Some of these children have treatment for many years, and it can get rather tedious just coming in every so often and saying, do this, do that, pull your foot up and down and so forth. Whereas if we can actually show the child what their muscles are doing, then they begin to appreciate that it is this particular movement that's doing it. So we've got it all set up.
A similar kind of visual feedback helps Sadie overcome her general muscular weakness, except this time, when her arm moves, a line appears on the screen. The idea is to control the line and try to hit all the red trains.
The results so far suggest that really it's going to be very worthwhile working on these lines. I think there's tremendous potential using this method, using the equipment, the computer and the feedback as a tool for various aims that we might have in physiotherapy. I think we'll try it at that one for the time being.
So computers can help people to control movement.
How long have you had this plaster on?
But what if you can't move your legs at all? Jan Burgess broke her back in a trampoline accident 14 years ago and is confined to a wheelchair. Some years ago, she met Dr. Hugh Grenfell. With his help, her life began to change. Jan slips on a harness fitted with electrodes. gel on the pads makes a good electrical contact between these electrodes and her leg muscles. Using this harness and a portable walking frame, she has taken her first steps since her accident. Although experimental and as yet unavailable on the DHSS, this equipment has been a real breakthrough. The most vital piece of the equipment is a small computer which she straps securely around her waist. Then she connects it to the electrodes on her leg harness. When it's switched on, the job of the computer is to send a controlled amount of power to her leg muscles. It's this power which makes her legs move. She tests the amount of power that she needs until she feels confident that her legs will support her. The computer has two small hand controls which she attaches to her walking frame where she can reach them easily. Then she switches on the power. Hugh Grenfell is using this equipment with over 100 patients now, but Jan was his first guinea pig.
In the early days when we started off, of course we had very little equipment. A lot of it was very funny because things happened that we weren't expecting. When I actually stood for the first time, it was fairly frightening. But once I'd conquered that, we didn't look back.
Jan wouldn't say that she can walk very far. That would be much too difficult and tiring. But there are advantages.
I can do short distances, which are very useful. The main difference it's made is my fitness. And it's helped tremendously. I've lost enormous amount of weight. I feel much fitter. I've got more energy. And my circulation has improved. Everything's improved. Obviously, if you're going along a flat surface, then this isn't an enormous aid because I can whiz along flat surfaces in the chair without any problem. But if I wanted to read a book and it was on the top shelf, I would have to wait until somebody came and got me the book. Whereas now I can roll up to the bookcase, get my walking frame, stand up, pick myself the book, come down and read it. So it's given me a little more freedom, really, than I had before. I think the implications for this sort of work in the future are very far-reaching. I am really a very bad subject to take because my break is such a high one. I have no movement at all from under my armpits down. Therefore, that gives me greater immobility than many others. People who already are able to use their back muscles and perhaps the hip muscles will need far less equipment than I will need and should be able to utilise it far quicker because they have much more movement to start off with. I think anyway it will improve everybody's health because it's a marvellous way of using your own muscles to exercise yourself rather than having somebody come in and exercise for you.
Like Jan, many disabled people still have to rely on a wheelchair. And wheelchairs haven't changed much over the years. The most common chairs issued by the DHSS are the standard ones you push yourself. And many people, especially the elderly or those who want to exercise their arms and shoulders, are perfectly happy with them. But if your arms are weak, or you're not intimidated by technology, one of these new powered chairs could make a real difference. They are expensive and are not available through the DHSS. But for people like Keith Smith, they've brought a degree of independence which makes the cost worthwhile. Keith's chair is battery powered, but what makes it special is a built-in energy-saving computer. When he's climbing curbs or riding over rough surfaces, it automatically gives him just the right amount of power to keep going smoothly. Until he contracted severe diabetes, Keith was a steeplejack, used to the outdoor life. But to begin with, he had a DHSS chair that he wasn't legally allowed to take further than his garden gate. He hated being stuck indoors, and his wife had to push him everywhere. Then he found the outdoor Wayfarer chair, which he can operate easily himself, using the strength in his right hand. It changed his life. Suddenly, he was independent again.
I can go where I like, when I like it. The biggest difference in my life, it's my legs now. I can do anything anybody else can do.
He's even done a marathon to raise money for charity. After 3 days and 100 miles, the chair was still going strong.
I was chuffed to get it. But you can't, if anybody can do anything better with a wheelchair than what this is, this computer, the best of luck to them, because I don't think they can. And I've tried a lot of different chairs.
So technology can make a powered wheelchair even better. But Graham Cook has no strength to operate the controls on a powered chair. An industrial accident left him completely paralysed, but now, with the help of two switches on either side of his head and a small TV monitor, he's able to get around again. On the TV screen are the words forwards, backwards, left, right, and so on. As Graham presses one switch, a marker on the screen points to each command in turn. The other switch operates the chair when he's decided which way to go. The system is run by a computer on the back of the chair. It was specially designed for him by a small Gloucester company called Elfin. Graham's accident also left him without speech. In his bedroom, he has a whole array of other computer equipment which helps him to communicate. He operates it using the same two switches. By choosing letters and phrases from a large word store, he can now compose sentences. Here, he explains how he feels about his chair. He explains that he can move himself around wherever he wants without help. Graham feels it's the difference between existence and living. Ruth Everard also has an unusual wheelchair. She's 5 years old and was born with an incurable muscular disease, which means she will spend her life in a wheelchair. Her parents wanted her to be able to move around on her own as much as possible, but they couldn't find any powered wheelchairs suitable for children.
I think when children are very small, it's easy to push them about. They look normal in pushchairs. All children go in pushchairs at that age. It's easy to carry them. They're fairly small. And there isn't seen to be such a need for them to have their own independent mobility. Also, of course, people have been worried in the past about children with physical problems not developing their full physical potential if they're given an easy kind of mobility like powered mobility.
But the Everards disagreed, and Ruth's father, who is an engineer, designed her a chair himself. This is the result, the Turbo, which takes rough surfaces, curbs and slopes in its stride.
Ruth was only 19 months old when she first had her first wheelchair, the predecessor to the Turbo, and she had 6 to 8 weeks of very tentative trying to push the joystick and pressing the buttons and getting out after 10 minutes because she was a bit scared of movement. But once she discovered it was fun to move, there was one just magical day when she discovered that it was fun to go round and round backwards in circles. And from then on, she had all the skill at her fingertips.
The Turbo has also allowed Ruth to fit into a normal school without having to rely on others to push her around. The computer program which controls the joystick has been specially designed for her so that her weak hands have no problem pushing the stick forwards or backwards, or pressing a button to make the seat rise up to table height or down to the floor.
The Turbo has the effect of enabling her to make her own choices and be active in carrying them out. If she decides to be naughty, she can be naughty, which is something that a disabled child usually, an immobile child usually, can't be. They have to take what comes and what is laid out for them. And so she obviously has to learn discipline, just like other children.
I can get up to the high tables and pick things up off the ground, which I couldn't do if I didn't have this chair.
Ruth's experience of getting herself about could be important in the future too, if she learns to drive. Those people who've learnt to judge space, distance and speed by themselves, rather than continually being pushed, are much more likely to adapt quickly to driving a car. Here at Banstead Place Mobility Centre, technology is helping many disabled people not only to drive, but also with many other related problems. Christine has spina bifida. She can't drive yet, but she wants to find out what aids are available to help her get in and out of a car, either as a driver or a passenger. Banstead has a range of aids and adaptations that any disabled person can come and try out, including boards which help you slide into the driver's seat and special hoists for wheelchairs. In this van is some of Banstead's most impressive computerised equipment. It's used to test drivers' reactions and assess what car adaptations they might need. Sarah is 17 and wants to learn to drive. She's come to test her reactions and see whether her size will be a problem.
Now, the lights on top of the dashboard are going to come on in various sequences, but you'll always get either more reds or more greens.
Right.
If there are more reds, we want you to press the paddle that's marked red. If there are more greens, you press the paddle that's marked green.
Right.
Yes?
Yeah.
Right, are you ready?
Yes.
Away you go. Watch carefully.
A computer records her reactions and gives her a printed assessment which helps her to set her mind at rest. She will still have to take her test, but at least she'll know that driving is a possibility.
Right, Bob, if you watch the screen very carefully, you'll see a series of lights come on.
Bob, unlike Sarah, drove for many years until he suffered a stroke.
Or you hear a buzzer. Mm-hmm. Now, the first one that you see will be the brake lights on the blue car will come on. Good. Back to the accelerator, watch the dog. Fine. Back to the accelerator, you're on your own now.
Bob has come to Banstead to test his reactions and make sure that he can still drive safely. He goes through a number of different tests, each of which involves trying out different brake systems, steering columns, and so on. The computer records his reactions, and the final assessment will help him decide which set of controls will suit him best. Banstead also has a number of cars with different adaptations to suit different disabilities. And there's a special driving track, complete with road markings and lights, where people can practice their driving without going into traffic. Bob's stroke paralysed him down his right side. Now he can try out the adaptations suggested by the assessment, which will enable him to control a car using only his left side. Alison Lapper is one of Banstead's many success stories. She's been through the whole process from start to finish and came out driving.
They checked my eyesight and my reactions, you know, how quick I reacted and how strong I was in each leg and in my shoulder. Obviously, just to see, you know, how much power I could put on the brakes and accelerator and what have you. I thought Banstead was very good. Obviously, it helped me to find out what I could do and what I couldn't do and what was possible. And to find out, obviously, that driving was going to be a possibility, really.
After 5 months, she had learnt to drive and passed her test, using race controls that she works with her feet and a steering wheel which she operates with her shoulder, both adaptations suggested by Banstead.
When I came to get a car, a lot of the problems were the money side of it, because it was £10,000, you know, and where do you find that kind of money? We solved the money by begging, literally, you know, please help, literally, because, I mean, obviously I put up as much money as I could, but I couldn't find £10,000. So we had to ask, you know, and obviously people were generous enough to help.
The difference that driving has made to Alison has been well worth the cost.
Driving has meant to me independence. I can go anywhere I want, anytime I want, just jump in the car and I can go. And it brings me on a level with everybody else. In my car, I'm not disabled, I'm just standing in my car, which is a really great feeling, it's lovely.
Microtechnology can add a new dimension to getting about. But if you want to find out more, where can you go for help? Motability is a voluntary organisation which can tell you about specially adapted cars and computer-controlled wheelchairs and advise you on how best to spend your mobility allowance. Your physiotherapist or occupational therapist will tell you about new techniques of controlling or exercising your muscles. If you have a problem getting around on public transport, then contact the Department of Transport. All this information is in our free booklet, details after the programme. Whatever your age or your particular handicap, being disabled shouldn't have to mean losing the freedom to get out and about just like anyone else.